Living in a warm and sunny country such as South Africa is great, but unfortunately, with it comes all the parasites and diseases associated with a warm tropical climate. And if you are also living in the southern parts of the United States, you will know what I'm talking about. Now, one of these parasitic buggers is called ticks, and although they are very tiny, they can be extremely deadly, especially if they carry parasites such as babesiosis that can kill your pet within days without the proper treatment. So in this video, I will be explaining exactly what tick fever or babesiosis in dogs is, as well as what the clinical signs, causes, diagnosis, treatment and prevention methods are, so that you can know exactly what to look out for and what to expect the next time that you find a tick on your dog's body. Now, babesiosis, also known as tick fever, bilary or Bosley squash in South Africa, is a protozoan tick-borne disease, meaning it is transmitted when infected ticks bite and feed on animals. The Babesia species are found worldwide and are very common in South Africa and in the southern parts of the United States. Now, babesiosis can also be transmitted from an infected mother to her unborn puppies through the uterus, what we refer to as transplacentally. And a dog may also get infected when he receives a blood transfusion through the tainted blood from an infected donor. And there's kind of mixed evidence with regards to whether direct animal-to-animal transmission can occur, such as when an infected dog with oral lesions or abrasions bites another dog. Now, having a parasite in your red blood cells does not go undetected by your immune system. Infected red blood cells are identified and destroyed by the immune system, thus killing the Babesia organisms within them as well. But oftentimes, the host's immune system will begin destroying the uninfected red blood cells as well, what we call an immune-mediated hemolytic anemia. And this can result in anemia, which is a severe lack of red blood cells in the body. Now, this is bad news, as one of the main functions of red blood cells is to transport oxygen to all the organs. And the fewer the red blood cells, the less oxygen is delivered and the higher chance that some organ damage will occur. Now, dogs infected with babesiosis may present with quite a variety of clinical signs, ranging in severity from a subtle and slow progression infection with no apparent clinical signs, to an immune-mediated hemolytic anemia, to a sudden collapse with systemic shock. The signs that you typically need to look out for include abnormally dark bloody urine, fever, weakness, pale mucous membranes, jaundice, which is a yellowish discoloration of the skin, gums, and white parts of the eye, depression, swollen lymph nodes, inappetence, nausea, an abnormally large spleen, and in severe cases, seizures. If babesiosis develops very far, then dogs can go into a state which we refer to as complicated babesiosis. In these severe cases, multiple organ systems starts to become affected, including the lungs, liver, kidneys, and nervous system. Now, your vet will start off with getting a full history, and it will be really helpful if you can provide information such as when your dog started showing clinical signs, if your dog's ectoparasitic treatment is up to date, and if your dog is frequently exposed to areas with tall grass, such as on a farm. He will then proceed to perform a proper clinical examination, where you will specifically look at the dog's mucous membranes, listen to the heart, feel the lymph nodes, take the dog's temperature, and palpate the abdomen. Now, when we see an abnormally elevated temperature, we are often encouraged to make a blood smear using a small drop of blood that we usually get by making a small prick on one of the ears. A blood smear is probably one of the best and cheapest diagnostic tests available that can tell us quite a lot of what is going on inside the dog's body. Now, with tick fever specifically, we expect to see the Babesia parasites infiltrating the red blood cells, and they often look tear-shaped and are usually found in pairs. We may also see other types of red blood cell changes, such as anisocytosis, serocytes, and schizocytes. Now, dogs with tick fever often also have other tick-borne diseases, such as tick bite fever, which we call ehrlichiosis, and if this is the case, we will also sometimes see changes in the white blood cells, what we call a merula. There are also other more advanced diagnostic tests available, such as fluorescent antibody stain, ELISA, and PCR tests that can be used to diagnose babesiosis. but these often have their own limitations as well. Your vet may also decide to perform a urinalysis and send the blood away for blood tests. These blood and urine tests usually reveal an anemia, which is a low red blood cell count, a thrombocytopenia, which is a low platelet count, hypoalbuminemia, which is a low number of a type of blood protein called albumin, and hemoglobinuria or bilirubinuria, which is a dark pigment that shows up in the urine resulting from the breakdown of red blood cells in the body. Now, the best FDA-approved treatment for babesiosis in dogs is imidacarb dipropionate, also known as 4A, and another drug called diminazine acetyrate, also known as Berinol, has been used in the past, but this is a very dangerous drug that can kill the dog if overdosed or accidentally injected into the bloodstream. Other newer alternative drugs, such as atovaquone and azithromycin, have also been prescribed, and they seem to be quite promising. Now, if a dog is not responding well to the antiprotozoan therapy, and there is evidence of an immune-mediated destruction of red blood cells, your vet may put your dog on prednisolone to suppress the immune system. Your vet may also add a long-term antibiotic such as doxycycline if concurrent ehrlichiosis is suspected. And when dogs present in a severe acute form, they often need to be hospitalized, put on a drip to receive intravenous fluids, and if the red blood cells are very low, then they might also need a blood transfusion with some liver support. Now, these dogs can take several days to recover, which can end up making treatment very expensive, especially when intensive hospitalization is involved. Now, treatment does relieve the symptoms of babesiosis, but in many cases, it does not fully clear the parasite from the body. Dogs may remain infected at a very low level, and babesia can therefore flare up again in times of stress or reduced immune function. Now, unfortunately, there is currently no effective vaccine commercially available to protect dogs against babesiosis. There is a vaccine that will prevent the life-threatening side effects, but none that will prevent babesiosis completely. But the best means of preventing babesiosis is by preventing your dog's exposure to the ticks that carry the parasite in the first place. Now, there are several products available on the market that will help prevent ticks from infesting your dog, ranging from dips, shampoos, and spot-ons. Tick collars also work well, but these can be dangerous, especially if your dog manages to bite and chew on the collar, which will end up poisoning him. Consult your local veterinarian on which product would work best for your specific doggo, and I will leave a couple of links to my personal top recommendations down in the description if you want to check them out as well. Now, it is also important to keep the grass and bush trimmed in your yard and avoid taking your dog to places such as woods or fields with tall grass, especially during the warmer seasons where the tick burdens are at a high. Inspect your dog daily for ticks, and if you find some, safely pull them off, making sure you remove the tick's head as well by grabbing the tick as close to the dog's skin as possible. Now, the prognosis for a dog that was diagnosed with babesiosis is unfortunately guarded, and it really depends on which of the body systems were affected and how advanced the disease developed before treatment was started. If you notice any of the symptoms mentioned in this video, then take your dog to the vet immediately. Babesiosis takes about 10 to 20 days to make your dog sick, and you may therefore not link the disease symptoms with finding a tick on your dog. Waiting even one day too long can make the difference between life and death. The quicker babesiosis is diagnosed and treated, the higher the chance of survival for your pet. You should also be aware that even dogs that survived babesiosis often remain subclinically infected, which means that these dogs may suffer a relapse of the disease in the future. Dogs that have recovered from babesiosis should never ever be used as donors for blood transfusions due to the risk that the recipient may also develop the disease. So to conclude, responsible pet ownership is the name of the game in preventing life-threatening tick-borne diseases, and this includes keeping your pets parasite-free and consulting your veterinarian whenever you are concerned about your pet's well-being. Thank you for watching this video. If you found the content to be helpful, I would really appreciate it if you can leave a like on this video and share it with your friends and your family. And let me know down in the comments if your dog ever suffered from tick fever and what you and your vet did to help him. And if you are new to my channel, consider subscribing. as I'll be posting new videos on interesting pet-related topics every week. And as always, have a lekker day. I'll see you in another video next week. Cheers.